Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our facilitators. Director of Design and Innovation Programs, Southern Methodist University, Kate Canales. And Education Lead, IDEO, Sandy Spiker.
Hello, I'm Kate.
And I'm Sandy.
And we are so delighted that you've chosen to spend the afternoon with us at the Design Lab. We are both designers and therefore qualified to take you through the process that we're about to take you through. That really is our role, to guide you through a process to getting to some really new, innovative ideas in this space. And design often starts with inspiration, so we're going to kick it off with a video to inspire you and get you in the right frame of mind.
At the age of 2.5, almost 85% of a child's brain development is complete. During the first 6 years of life, the critical development of social, emotional, and cognitive skills occurs. Preschool and early learning centers can help strengthen these skills, yet that's not the only place for education. Parents, families, and communities are also essential in creating productive, informal learning environments. But the poorest mothers spend most of their hours finding fuel, fresh water, and cooking meals. The time can't always be found to provide a young child with the stimulation and education they need. A child who goes to preschool is not only more likely to finish primary and secondary school, but they are also more likely to have a higher positive impact on their country's GDP. Early access to education sets everyone up to be a productive member of the worldwide community. Despite all of this, only 46% of children worldwide are enrolled in pre-primary education. That figure falls to 13% in the least developed countries. How do we make sure that more young children, no matter their socioeconomic background, get the chance to start off right?
Okay, so hopefully you can tell this is the Early Childhood Education Design Lab. Anybody feel they need to go to a different session? Okay, great. We're all here for this one. How many of you have been to a design lab between today and yesterday? Great. So you have a sense of what this is about. For those of you that didn't raise your hand. Wow, that's really different. Okay, so let me do that again. How many of you have been to a design lab so far? Great, so I guess you liked it in order to come back to another one, huh? So for those of you that haven't been to a design lab, this is a new format for CGI, and what we're trying to do with this is to be in a generative frame. So looking at some of the problems that we face in the world, what new solutions might we be able to imagine that could help address this challenge? This video obviously gave you some context for that. To give you a sense of what we're going to do in the next 90 minutes, we're going to start out by providing you with some inspiration. We have some great experts here who can give you more context into this challenge. We're going to invite you to share at your tables the things that you may already be doing in this space or the things that you felt inspired by from the experts. And we're going to offer you three different challenges to brainstorm on. So how many of you are used to brainstorming in your daily lives? We're going to structure that for you, and we're going to do it fast. We're going to give you three challenges, and we're giving you 7 minutes each at your tables to be working together to imagine new solutions for that. And then we're going to give you a little bit of time to take one of those solutions and build it out in a little bit more detail. And I have to be honest, I was just told that the session before us did amazing things during that refinement session. So We're gonna be looking at all, yeah, to see what you create during that. We're gonna have the early childhood education create the most amazing prototypes. So we're gonna flesh out some of those ideas, share them back with the room, and have a great discussion about it. Does that make sense? It's gonna feel really fast. That's part of the design. Part of that is that it kind of keeps you moving. We're gonna ask that you don't think too hard about everything. Just get your intuitions out there. Be in dialogue with each other. Be really open. And learn from each other. There are amazing minds with amazing talents and amazing experiences. And at your tables, You are all multidisciplinary teams coming together with a lot of different backgrounds. So what we're hoping to see out of this session is what all of your different skills and backgrounds can create together. Does that make sense? Great. Okay. Look to Kate.
So to get us kicked off, we have some truly impressive women with us who are experts in this space, and we're going to let them spend some time educating us on the state of the situation, and we'll get ready to do some brainstorming. Oh, we wanted to encourage you while we're listening to what they have to say to jot some notes that you can refer back to later in the session. So listen for things that surprise you, things that inspire you, anything that kind of touches you or makes you think about the issue in a new way. It's going to be helpful to have those things written down so you can go back and refer to them later. So without further ado, it is my pleasure to introduce Rhonda Grob-Zakhary, who is the CEO from the LEGO Foundation, and Jacqueline Jones, who's the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Policy and Early Learning at the U.S. Department of Education.
I'm not worried about the solutions that will come out from today because I know in this area everyone has so much passion, and I'm sure that will be brought to bear. I'd like to ask everyone for just a moment to be totally silent. It's already pretty quiet, but just extremely still and quiet for a moment. Now in New York, the sound is extremely precious, the sound of silence. A lot of us value that. But for children, this silence is absolutely deafening. This silence dampens the sounds of normal development. For example, the sounds of robust chatter between a caregiver or a parent and a child, or between children. Or the sounds of a child gasping for delight or clapping their hands when they've mastered a new challenge. Or sounds of music, or any of those things that we associate with children who are learning and developing in a happy and secure environment. To get us kicked off before the design lab, I'm going to share three facts about brain growth. Some of you may know them, but I know there are also novices in the room, and so I'd like to make sure that we're all on the same playing field before we kick off today. So these three facts about growth, they're so critical because they are the chemical and biological reasons why the early years are such an incredible opportunity. And when we forget this, we don't treat the children with the respect that they need for later development. The first fact, and most people have heard this, most brain growth happens in the first 5 years. That's not a surprise to many of us. And thankfully, most of us have progressed since we turned five. But that's not necessarily due to growth, that's due to refinement and maturation of our nerves in the brain. Even though growth happens so much in the first 5 years, some people don't know that it's actually heavily concentrated, as the video showed, in the first 3 years. 80% of growth happens in the first 3 years, and roughly 90% by the age of five or six. So that was fact one. Most growth happens in the first 5 years. Fact two, and this tends to surprise a few more people, we are born with all the nerves we will ever have. And for my fellow doctors and neuroscientists in the room, there are a few special exceptions, but for most cases, we don't develop new nerves. We don't grow nerves when we learn. We're born with all the ones we'll ever have, and they already start dying in the fetus period. We just lose as we get older. So then you might ask, well, then how do our brains grow? Why do they take up more space? And this is because unlike other organs, which end up growing in size or developing new cells, what happens in the brain are two things that need more space. The first is the development of new connections. Some of you may know them as synapses, and this makes the brain work better. The second thing that happens is a special insulation, a special fat. We won't be too technical today, I promise, but a special fat that is critical for nerves to function in the brain, called myelin, some of you might know that term, enables nerves to work much more effectively. It enables nerves to create pathways that otherwise would not be possible without this fat. Those are the two ways the brain grows. But again, that second key fact is that no new nerves form after birth. The third key fact, the last key fact about neuroscience today, is that these things I just told you about, new connections and this fat, they develop in a predictable, programmed timetable. Now, not everybody, as you know, not every child develops the same things at the same time, but they happen in the same sequence. And it's exactly because of this predictable, pre-programmed timetable. And this, now you all know in the room, this is what accounts for a child's milestones. This is why children don't crawl or don't walk before they crawl. This is why they begin to talk with a word explosion around 1.5 to 2.5 years. This is even why you see things like separation anxiety happening at a very predictable time, and also the terrible twos. It's simply due to an imbalance of this fatty insulation formation between parts of the brain that control rage and parts of the brain that have to do with self-control. It's all about this pre-programmed timetable. The consequence of this is something very important for us today called critical periods. Many of us have heard of those. Let's explain in 30 seconds what they actually are. It's in this pre-programmed timetable that there are certain periods of very fast connection formation and this fatty insulation formation. There are periods where these things happen so quickly on top of normal development, and those things represent for us a special time window of opportunity. It means during this period that children are exquisitely sensitive to the experiences they receive. And that is true for language, for example, between the ages of 1 to 3, especially sensitive for language, but every function has a critical period. It's not that things don't happen after that, of course they do, but those periods are especially sensitive. For example, hearing. You know, babies come out being able to hear. That's because the critical period for hearing happens in the womb. Seeing happens shortly after birth, and so forth. I think you get the picture. The point of describing those three key facts is to leave you with this. If we don't build it in the first 5 years for many functions, we cannot build it back. We can work on it, we can refine it, but we cannot build it back. Can I have the slide, please? If we take a non-neurologic example, looking at these plants with roots, just to make it really practical, what we've been talking about here today is that early brain development in the first 5 years is like building the roots of a plant over its lifetime. Now, trying to build back roots after the early years is like trying to grow a plant by putting a leaf in the ground. It simply doesn't work. Now, there are ways we can approach this problem to ensure that that we make the situation as good as possible, and those include things like early childhood education, of course. I prefer that we would address it as early childhood learning, because I think education gives the idea that it's only about school. For today's design session, we're not only talking about school. It's about formal and informal learning in and outside of the home from ages 0 to 5. For today's exercise, preschool is defined as those from 3 to 5. And those are the children where they also have a specially unique opportunity to make a difference in how they will prepare to learn how to learn for later school. And finally, school readiness is an important part, an important goal of early childhood education in helping children learn both how to develop in a classroom, how to meet the demands of a classroom, but also how to benefit from a classroom. And so we have a lot of challenges on the way, but all the things I told you today, now you know those things. But too many leaders who make decisions are not aware of those facts. If they would be aware, we wouldn't have a world where we have 200 million children each year under the age of 5 who fail to realize their cognitive and social potential. And as you heard in the video, less than half have access to preschool globally. And in the least developed countries, this falls to 13%. The good news is there are a number of promising examples about which my colleague Jacqueline will now discuss.
Thank you. You know, this critical period is so important to children's growth and development and their lives that we have to figure out a way to make sure that every child reaches their potential. And so my job today is to give you a sense of why it matters, what we know will happen if we provide good early care and education, what we know happens if we don't, And then some examples of the ways in which people have been trying around the world to make this work, to make a commitment to early childhood education or early childhood care really, really meaningful. So if you think about today's session at noon, which I thought was a wonderful panel discussion, we heard that in Mozambique, with just a year of preschool, there was a 24% increase in school attendance. It's not much of an investment, but it's certainly a really good return. What we know about this return on our investment comes a great deal from three studies that have been done in the States, three very longitudinal studies. And I say very longitudinal because they follow children now for 40 years. That is about as longitudinal as you can get. So these are studies, the Perry Preschool, Abecedarian, the Chicago Parent-Child Study. These are really important studies because they are high-quality early care and education programs that are targeted to disadvantaged children. And what do we learn? We learn that these children are more likely to complete high school, that they are twice and sometimes four times as likely to graduate from college. We learned that there are certainly in their lives fewer incidents of crime, half the drug-related crimes. Certainly, they contribute more to the economy. Indeed, they lead much more productive lives. This is a very small investment for a huge, huge return. And we know this across the country because we see these same results constantly bearing out. Children in Colombia, in Brazil, in Argentina, these children with some early childhood education and care show much lower rates of retention, grade retention, which is very costly, aside from having a tremendous emotional impact on children. So we see these programs in, as I said, in South America. In my own state of New Jersey, where I was lucky enough to be able to run the preschool program, we had preschool programs for 3 and 4 year old children in 31 of the poorest districts in New Jersey. Now, New Jersey has some very wealthy districts, but when we have poor districts, we really do have poor districts. So we're talking Newark and Trenton and Camden and all those places. What we found was with high-quality preschool, we could cut in half the grade retention. We moved from 10.7% to 5.3%. This is huge. We could also reduce the numbers of children who have special education classifications because we hit those kids early with good, solid early childhood education and care, and they did not need to be classified in special education categories. Indeed, they did very, very well. So as you look at the data across the world, it's very consistent. We don't see cases where we've provided high-quality early care and education and nothing happens. We simply don't see that. We see a huge return. We see children doing better in the short term, children and families doing much better in the long term. So where have people been trying to do this work? Well, if we look at Peru, their Good Start initiative provides support to pregnant women and their children from prenatal to age 3. This is not all across the country, but it is a really important effort. In Kenya, with assistance from UNESCO, Kenya has adopted early care and education as a mandatory component of basic education, and they did this in 2011. In the United States, our Head Start and early Head Start programs have been going on now for 40 years, and the federal government has really put a huge amount of effort into targeting the poorest children in this country. And what do we see? We see enormous gains. We have issues with quality, and we are working very hard to make sure that quality is sustained, that quality is consistent across programs. This is an important program. The latest work that we have in this country comes from the federal government with an investment of over $600 million that goes directly to states to help states to coordinate every aspect of early education, early care and development. So Head Start, child care, state-funded preschool, IDEA, that's special education, all of these funding streams that are so disconnected now have a way to come together to provide a coordinated system. No child says, I'm Head Start only, I'm special ed only. Children and families should not know where the money comes from that meets their needs. They simply need to be able to get good care. So these programs are going on in an attempt to try to make sure that children get the best they need. However, what do we see? We see that health promotion, family engagement, well-qualified staff, high standards, good teaching can all significantly increase school success, health outcomes, and provide a high quality of success and life for children and their families. What are the issues that we face, though? We see programs that need to be scaled up, programs that need to be sustained. We see an increasing, a continued need to increase access to high quality programs for children with high needs. These needs don't go away. And so around the world, we still have the issue of how do we make sure that folks understand the importance of early childhood education, to make sure they understand the benefits that are huge. There is no other investment that we see across the educational spectrum that gets us the kinds of returns that we get if we start early. We talk about an achievement gap, and we've talked about it, we've studied it, we've admired it. We actually know what to do about it, but we have to make that commitment. We have to make that commitment to children and their families to make sure that they get the best that we can give them. So this continues to be an issue around the world, but it's an issue that you can fix this afternoon.
So I will wrap, Sana, I'll wrap up by talking about some of the gaps and opportunities that come out of some of the work Jacqueline talked about. But I'm going to start with a specific example or two examples. I spent the last few weeks traveling to see some of our work in South Africa and Brazil. And most recently, I was in São Paulo, and I would love to share with you two examples of places that are dealing with early education, because they create a really concrete way of looking at some serious gaps that are shared in projects across the world. So if you can imagine taking this trip with me, we walk into a care center in a favela or a slum in São Paulo. And in this center, it's maybe not so much different from what you would expect. When we walk in, it's rather silent. We see a lot of children there who are sitting relatively motionless without expression. They're sitting in corners, some are talking to one another, but they're really not engaged. They don't have a lot of materials to play with. It's actually difficult in some cases to tell the difference between some of the older children and some of the younger teachers. You really don't see who is leading whom. You don't see a lot of activity. You don't see a lot of motion. When we speak with the director of the center, she tells us that she's not really sure what happens to the graduates. They're not really tracked or in the system. She's not really aware of anyone who's gone on to higher education. And it's just not, you know, it doesn't leave a very strong feeling of hope. Hope is not present. Then a short drive away in another care center, which actually feeds children to the same school during the day. So children of these two different centers would meet during the day, but they go to different after-school centers, which is important in Brazil because they spend only 4 hours a day in the classroom. At this other center, some of you might have heard of it, it's called the Casa do Zezinho. You walk inside this place, and this is a paradise. This is a place where hope lives. Here daily, 1,200 children come and engage in the most incredible activities you don't even see necessarily in first world environments. We walk in and there are children writing stories, making music, engaging in sports, exploring the science lab, even building and programming robots. And one of the teachers is very proud to show us a newsletter that they produced based on equipment that was donated from a partner in the community, which is an extremely professional looking newsletter, which describes all the activities of the school, which they happen to use with partners to generate more support. We also see that a lot of the staff are former students who had been there and who had developed and gone on to further school and had come back. And one condition of being an employee there is that you must continue your education. So there's this constant development and investment. And finally, what was so incredible is that they also invest in the parents and the community around the school. They have evening and weekend programs to lift the educational level and to give social support for the people around them. So if we ask ourselves in this little community, just a few kilometers apart, what makes these things different? Because that gives us insight into what are some key opportunities for us today in the design lab Hopefully you'll have many more, and this is just a short list, but I hope you will think of many more in your sessions. What makes these two examples different? And if we go to this picture again of the plant, I'd just like to go here for a moment because it gives us the context of what is the reason these things differ. If I show this picture in a room of 100 people and I ask, what does a plant need to grow? Nearly everyone says immediately, food and water. Then a few more, nearly half will answer, also sunlight, which we can think of today as an analogy for education. Only a few think to discuss the quality of the soil, which is critical. If you look here, it's not all black. There's all these little things in the soil, and I'm not a botanist, and I won't pretend to be, but I do know there are a ton of things in the soil that are critical, the nutrients, the insect remnants, which have some nutritional value for the plant, and so forth. The point is, what's different about these two examples is the environment that the children are in, the quality of the soil that the roots are taking hold in. And so if I just go through four things, and I have to limit myself because of the time. The first is that this second example, the Caso dos Zinho, recognizes that early childhood learning is early childhood development. You cannot treat education alone. It recognizes the UN respected trio of cognitive support, to be sure, physical well-being, and social and economic security. And let me give you a short neurologic fact why this is so important, the social economic security. When we are stressed, anyone in the room, when we get stressed, our body releases a little bit of cortisol. And for most of us, it's no problem. Get a little surge, it goes away, no big deal. For children who live in stress, whether it's poverty, hunger, trafficking, abuse, violence, whatever it is, these children grow up in an environment where their brain sees a chronically elevated level of cortisol. And we know from work in the last 3 years that when that level of cortisol is high for a few years in those early years, the brain develops in a way that can never be corrected or improved. It develops in a way that's very different from a child who doesn't see those circumstances. So moving again away from the plant, this is so critical when we talk about this early childhood learning being early childhood education, and that's what the second example saw. They involve the parents, they involve the community, and they recognize that to lift the children, we must lift the community around them. It is hard to do. It is a big challenge, but also we have to remember that it doesn't mean we do it alone. It means we find the right partnerships. We work with others who are doing the other things to make sure that the learning impact can actually take hold. The second major difference is the attention to communicating success, transparency of proven ideas. A little bit along the lines of what we heard from Jim Yong Kim yesterday with the Solutions Bank. Now, on a local level, this one little care center took the drive to communicate the success of their work and to secure partners, corporate partners and private partners in the area to invest and build. But on a more global level, this could really be a call for us to make sure that we invest more in sharing our successes and developing a communication platform and knowledge management, much in the way that the corporate world does. This is something that's missing from this area. The third major opportunity is to use technology. There are more children in this world who have access to mobile phones than have access to preschool. It will be faster for us to change this dynamic by using technology in a creative way to do something about this. Furthermore, you know, some children have access to tablets, internets, et cetera. Some of you may have heard of the hole-in-the-wall experiment by Sugata Mitra. The bottom line is that he found, we're not saying teachers should be removed, but he found that when he planted a PC in a hole in the wall, children taught each other who had never seen PCs before. They taught each other how to use a PC, and more importantly, how to use the PC to learn things. And that was a tremendous advantage that maybe we can take some benefit from. The last thing is this group focused on quality, which has come up today also from Jacqueline's talk. Access alone is not enough. Reach, which many of us measure our success by, is only an indicator. It doesn't measure impact. Learning is an impact. And that's actually relevant for us in the first world countries as well. Our education doesn't pay enough attention to quality of learning. Access alone cannot be enough. As the mother of two small children, age 4 and 5, I also see very clearly in very developed communities that quality of learning is something we all have to pay attention to. So in closing, I would say, we've all seen from all of this discussion, that if we change the first 5 years, we can change everything, absolutely everything. And if we do not prepare our children better for the future, we cannot prepare a better future for our children.
Thank you. All right, well, do you remember that now you're going to work on this? I heard Mel over here say, let's get to it. Okay, so thank you guys for that. That was incredibly inspiring. The next step in the design process is to share with your team the inspiration that you gained from these experts. So a lot of you in this room are actually also experts. A lot of you are working in this space already. What we'd love for you to do is make some quick introductions at the table. Let everybody who you're sitting with know who you are, and share some of the things that either you learned, that you were inspired by, or some of the things that you're working on that you think contribute to the inspiration in this space. We're going to have just a few minutes to do this. I'll give you a quick warning, but expect about 3 minutes. So quick intros, quick dialogue, and we'll keep working.
Okay, everyone, try to wrap up. We're going to call it in just a sec. Okay. I know it's short, and as Sandy promised, it's going to feel really fast today, but we need to kind of get everybody back up here, and we're going to move on to the next step.
Thanks.
In our process. Okay. Okay, well, what we're going to have you do next is some brainstorming. And, you know, we do brainstorming as a group because it really leverages everybody's expertise and it helps us get to a lot of ideas really quickly. Brainstorming is a word that we use a lot, and different people might have different meanings for what that exactly is as an activity. So we're going to provide you with a set of rules, which may seem counterintuitive because we definitely want you to get outside the box, but actually what we found is that using these rules helps you push your thinking and helps you function as a team really well and to get to those ideas. So my clicker lady is going to click while we go through these brainstorming rules. Feel free to enforce these if you need to at your tables. Today we want to encourage wild ideas. So if you have something that you don't think would maybe work for some reason, just say it anyway. Let's get all the crazy ideas out on the table today. Defer judgment, not just about the people that we're talking about in this case, but in particular about the ideas that your teammates are putting out on the table. So this is not the time to think about why something wouldn't work. We'll be able to judge later. Build on the ideas of others. So if you hear something that's interesting, or even if you hear something that you're pretty sure wouldn't work, that's a great opportunity to say, oh, that makes me think of this. So go ahead and build on that idea. That's how we get to more ideas. That's how we leverage one another. We're going for quantity. Linus Pauling was the one who said you have to get a lot of ideas to get a good idea. So that's what we're trying to do today. There will be a lot of bad ideas, but we're not judging them until later. So just go for quantity. And one conversation at a time. This is really important. This is how you function well as a group. So you really want to be able to hear your team. Now this is, you know, we're in a crowd, so there'll be a lot of noise in the room, but try to focus on one conversation at a time so you can hear one another and build on one another. And we're going to give you three topics, as Sandy said. Try to stay focused on each topic in turn. And this, again, helps us. And the last one is be visual. Try to draw a picture. I can't tell you how many times I've heard somebody say, well, I can't really draw, but you can. You can draw, and it doesn't have to be pretty. It has to be enough to communicate the idea. And I will say later when we come to judge the ideas, the ones that have drawings on them tend to be visually a little bit more interesting and tend to get more votes. I'm just throwing that out there. So if you really like an idea, you may want to draw a picture.
If you want your idea chosen, yeah. Draw a picture.
Yeah. Just a little trick, I know. So I think Sandy's going to introduce our topics.
Yes. So those are the rules in summary. We have pulled together three questions for you. You probably heard in the video and what our experts shared, these categories of thinking about formal settings for early learning, informal settings like the home, and perhaps even the tools and technologies that can help support that. So what we've done is we've framed three questions for you. Every good brainstorm begins with a challenge. We like to frame those challenges in terms of how might we questions. They are very optimistic. We think of how might we can start to think about possibility. And having a question actually helps us immediately think of answers. The first topic that you're going to work on connects to formal settings. You probably saw in the video that, especially in developing countries, only 13% of children have access to early childhood education. So we have a question for you here to work on. How might we connect more children around the globe to compelling and effective formal early childhood education settings? Or perhaps we could say early childhood learning settings. We've also given you some prompts up here, and I'm not going to read through all of them. But if you feel a little stuck at your table, or you feel like you're starting to analyze it, to be like, what kind of things should we be thinking about? There are some prompts up here for you. So for instance, in this one, you might want to consider, are there certain roles that the private sector might play? Or what are ways you can engage local communities to provide learning opportunities in more formal ways? So we have some provocations for you up here if you're feeling a little stuck, but I'm going to guess that that probably won't be needed. So we have three of these, and I'm going to read through these three, and then we're going to give you 7 minutes each, and I'm going to let you know, and we'll switch the slides. So this first one is about formal settings. The next one is about informal settings. So actually, Rhonda shared a lot of detail about child development. And one of the things that you might see around the globe is that that level of understanding doesn't necessarily exist in parents and families. And so a question we're asking is, how might we help parents, families, and communities understand the importance and relevance of early childhood education and developmental strategies? In that example that Rhonda shared, play is an important component of child development, and that's not necessarily something that everyone is aware of. How might we increase the awareness around that? And the third question is around tools and technology. So there are many amazing solutions, and there's a lot of knowledge already around tools to support early learning. So how might we equip schools, families, communities with the best of global educational tools and technologies? So this is about extending reach and leveraging what we already have. Does this make sense? Does this feel exciting? All right, so I'm going to bring it back to the first challenge, please. And Kate's going to just show you logistically what we're about to do.
So the mechanics of how this is going to work, you may see on your table there's some materials that are not traditionally part of a CGI meeting. This is a big part of this format. And what I think is best to do here, you'll see this large placemat type of thing in the middle of your table. This will be your capture tool. So you're going to want to take a post-it note per idea. Try to headline that idea, maybe give it a sticky name of some kind, and maybe draw a picture. One idea per post-it note. And if you would like, you can use there are three bars that go through the middle there. You can use one for each topic, although I imagine that, like this group, you'll just be overflowing. You won't have enough room for the ideas. I also want to let you know that there are facilitators around the room who are going to be going around to answer questions. And if you need to flag one of them, please be sure to do that. Facilitators, do you want to wave? Okay. Go. Have fun.
Okay, we're going to wrap up this first question about access to early childhood education. Ready for the second one? I want to make sure that everyone gets that we're transitioning now to the next question. We've got three provocations to go through. So we've just been through the how might we, that is about access. The second one is about informal settings. How might we help parents, families, and communities understand the importance and relevance of early childhood education and developmental strategies? So here you want to start brainstorming, thinking about tools, programs, communications you could create, etc. Good? All right, keep it going. Okay. Would you believe that was 7 minutes? Yes. We are now going to transition to the third design challenge. Is everybody with me? Yeah. You guys have been trained well by school, huh? All right, the third challenge. The third challenge is around technology. Are your brains exploding with all the ideas? Third category is tools and technologies. So here are the challenges. How might we equip schools, families, and communities with the best of global educational tools and technologies? Lots of great solutions out there. How can we extend that to other places? So think about creative financing models, distribution systems you can leverage, spaces, environments that you could use in new ways, technologies, tools. Good? 7 more minutes. Okay. That's the end of your time for the third brainstorm topic. It's super tough, isn't it? Okay, I was a teacher. This is an early childhood education room, right? So could I, who's been in the classroom? Join me. Shh. See, this is how you can tell who's been in the classroom, right?
Help a friend.
Hand is up in the air. If you hear me, clap once, right? Thank you. We've got different strategies here. I'm sure that felt really fast. We are time constrained, and hopefully that time constraint helped you defer judgment, be more generative. We just wanted to point out really quickly, we had 7 rules. Hopefully you remember those. 2 of those rules, one of them was to go for quantity. So Kate's done a quick skim of the room, and we just wanted to point out the group that we think really succeeded at that rule.
If there were a quantity award, and this is not scientific, I would give it to this table right here. Right here.
You guys want to hold up your placemat? Quantity. That's what quantity looks like. Now, a lot of you have many ideas on there. Right, so, but we just wanted to say there's a go for quantity. If anyone wants to take them on, we'll do a count at the end. Okay, and there was another rule, if you remember, that was be visual. Any group think that they really achieved that rule? There's a maybe over here, but I'm going to look. Oh, we've got a Lego duck. That's pretty visual. But Kate, you've seen the room.
Well,
what do you think?
The Lego duck is very impressive. And this table back over here in the corner had, I think at least half of their ideas have pictures associated with it. But in a final judgment, I will have to agree with the facilitators. There are cut out pictures of bananas and all kinds of stuff over here. So I think it goes back over in this corner.
Visual brainstorming. Good job.
Yeah.
All okay. Right. We're going to move on to the next step.
So we are going to ask you to do something really hard, especially given the time limit that we're going to give you to do it. We're going to ask you as a group to choose one idea to move forward with and refine. And when I say go, I might suggest that you use the little gold stars. Maybe everybody puts a star on their favorite idea and you let it be kind of a democratic process to try to get to that one idea quickly. You are going to, on your table is a worksheet that you can use to help guide your process of refining the idea. So you will be asked to give your idea a title. Do something kind of sticky. And, don't be afraid to be a little clever with the title of your idea. And a concept description. So this would be like the elevator pitch for your concept. There's a blue section in the middle that says define key moments or experiences for your constituents. How would the user of your idea experience your idea? How would they become aware of it? How would they purchase it if that's part of the journey? How would they reuse it? Some of these key moments. And then finally, a visualization. And we wanted to show you from some previous sessions just how exciting these can be. So don't be afraid to really go for it. Yes.
Use the construction paper and the scissors. Right.
Or go ahead and make an investment. This is real money. All right. We have a very short time turnaround on this, so get to an idea quickly and go for it.
You have about
8 minutes.
We should cut more time. If you're listening, tell your tables less than a minute. Should we do N 40, 39, 38, 37? 30 seconds. Facilitators, let your tables know. The pressure's on. Countdown begins. 17.
Okay, that's it. Time is up. Put those final touches on. Let's get quiet, and we're going to actually take the opportunity
clap your hands.
To share.
Sorry. Let's go and teach her. Thank you. Somebody clapped. Somebody clapped. All right, which do we want to start with? Implement tomorrow, 10 years out?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, since you've had an enormous amount of time to fully flesh out these ideas, what we'd love for you to do is present them to each other. No, I'm kidding. That sounds like so much pressure, right? Remember, the point of this session is that we're exploring possibilities, we're discovering new, flexing that idea generation muscle. So in this room, all the way through to the end of the session, there's no judgment. We're impressed no matter what. One of the things we'd love to do is to make sure that people beyond your table hear some of the things that you've been thinking about. Time-wise, we're not going to go one by one per table. So we have some prompts for you. We'd love to hear some ideas that you think could most benefit the constituents in this challenge. What is an idea that you think best serves the young? So who in here has an idea that they feel like they'd really love to share around that category? And we're just going to go, raise your hand if you feel at your table it represents that category really well. We've got a few categories we're going to throw out, and you can share your idea. Anybody think their idea really will benefit kids 0 to 6? All right. This table feels great and confident about their idea. So what we'd like for you to do...
The facilitator yeah. will come with a mic.
And then we'll do that table. Okay, great. We're going to do two tables under this category. I've got other provocations for you. Hold on. We're going to go with this table and then that table next, and then I'm going to throw out another prompt. What we'd like for you to do when you're sharing this idea, because again, of our time constraints, we'd love for you to just share the title and the description and maybe point something out in your prototype, but we don't really have time to hear every detail that you guys
tell me all that before I volunteered.
No. Oh, come on. You're going to be awesome. Bring it.
Okay, I'm going to be quick. Our concept is Kitty Tracked, the concept description, to develop an interactive tool or an app to help parents assess their own child's development and then teach them games that they can play with their child at home to encourage their development along. So it goes, developers and child development specialists get together, they develop the tool, it goes to mass marketers, then goes to parents, then goes to kids. So we have an app here and other things about happy children at home.
In 8 minutes, that's amazing.
Yeah, that's impressive.
That's it, we're done. That was the whole idea.
Great, so an app to help parents assess their kids' development.
And then teach them interventions and games to play to overcome whatever the lags are.
Excellent. Great. Thank you. How about this table over here?
I will hold and you.
You'll hold it? Okay.
Wow. I see dimension.
Yes. Okay, so the title of our concept is It Takes a Village and a Mom. So this is the village. And these are all of the kids inside of the village. And these are all of the parents holding hands and serving as connected units to really elevate the early childhood experiences of this village. The overall concept is that we are looking for high quality early learning and high quality people to teach and instruct in these high quality early learning experiences. Those are votes for us.
She won. That's the best idea.
There you go.
Yeah, it's like the millionth attendee or something. What is the... Fire alarm. We're looking to the CGI folks.
Alex just said, stay where you are.
We've been told, stay where you are.
We have some people finding out what's going on, so just stay seated, and I promise you, as soon as we know something, we'll let you know.
Work out how you want to present your idea. Oh, this is like your high school? Yeah, it's totally, it's a school.
Actually,
test.
That's the $1 million award for best idea, and they got it.
All right, everybody calm now.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we can continue.
Thank you. Okay. That was awesome, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Okay, it takes a village.
It takes a village and a mom. So we are consistently looking for people to be those instructional specialists for high quality early learning. And who can do that better than all of the moms who are out there, but who need the information in order to really provide those early learning opportunities for their kids. So the concept visualization is we really start with prenatal education, because everyone is going and receiving, hopefully most people are going and receiving some sort of prenatal care. So the information is given to moms then that helps them to become those teachers and become those trainers for their kids. We would set up a Khan Academy course to actually train all of the parents and grandparents and certify them in this early childhood education for their own children. And we would promote that Khan Academy course via all of the fantastic social media mechanisms that are globally accessible today, like Facebook, Twitter, et cetera, et cetera.
Great. Good job.
Awesome. Great. How about an idea that's really, what you've thought about for this idea is how to scale something? You guys thought about scale? Great. Great.
So we have one that has six design elements, and you can see there's a phone right here with a solar panel on it, which we can have it anywhere around the world. The name is Text for Toddlers. And it builds on the concept of text for babies. So it's an existing model that has had some track history. It's not only a technology, but a campaign that is powered by technology on the low and so very low end or a higher end. So the first is passive push text to the parents. And we wanted to make sure we included dads and moms, so moms or dads, but a push text based on how old the child is. So every week or every day, how many synapses? I think we heard 700 synapses per second as they're growing are formed. An active interactive component that may have text recognition, just recognize text, or audio text. And one of the great ideas my colleague here, my associate, described was the granny net that was involved with the hole in the wall project, where grandmas would be able to describe the function of the things. So you could have an expert network of either volunteers or some that were paid to be able to answer questions that weren't recognized by text. The fourth is a microfinance entrepreneurship function, so that there could be a microfinance function so that those who are involved champion it could get some funding for helping push it and champion it in a local region. And then we added a learning system so that as all this information is captured, frequently asked questions then could become part of a repository for the granny net or whoever. And then the sixth thing was literacy barriers, to make sure that we addressed our literacy barriers. And so it could be pure audio, so you could call in with a question or text and then get a recorded answer if you didn't know how to read, so that you could, you know, deal on the very lowest end with text or a higher end. And if it was higher end with a smartphone, you could show a video. I miss anything? Okay.
Great.
Perfect. Great. I love an idea that builds on something that's already been successful.
Some gasps in that corner of the room.
Yeah, we need to turn to that. Yeah. There was gasping.
Would you guys like
here.
To share yours?
There was gasping because ours is called Texts for Talk.
Whoa. I don't know if you've heard that from this corner of the room. But we have an innovation. We have an innovation ad, which is that. So we have here a cell phone that says, "Did you know most brain growth happens in years 0 to 5? Sing to your child today and get a $2 coupon for an Elmo sing-along toy."
Yeah.
And then we have here, "Save $2 on your next purchase of a sing-along Elmo," to help parents find products that help them to engage with their children. So that's it.
That's excellent. Great. What an incredible coincidence right there.
All right, we have a prompt for the room. Who has an idea that they think would get written up in the New York Times? You think? When hands go up quickly, all right, we'll do this table, then this table. Two ideas in this category. Next one will be USA Today. I'm just kidding. New York Times. New York Times. What's going to get you written up in the New York Times? All right, let's hear this group.
All right, wonderful. Okay, so this is interesting. It builds on a lot of things that we've heard, but it catalyzes many of the things. So we're talking about a global early childhood learning portal. It is an open source for all stakeholders, including kids, parents, teachers, NGOs, anybody with a vested interest. I'm glad we got there before you guys, because I'm seeing you last.
And that group
but
is sharing.
I don't think so. But to promote and share ideas, to incorporate research, to do evaluations, program activities, books, learning materials, to really catalyze a movement around early childhood learning, ultimately to nurture the development of children. So this is open source truly around the world that allows freedom of information sharing and a learning. It's a place where NGOs can share best practices with colleagues in affiliates in other parts of the world, where teachers can do the same, where teachers can go and teach other classes, where classes can interact, so on and so forth. There's so many, the Wikipedia, 1, 0 to 5, there's so many different elements. So this, of course, is a computer. And it starts with how do we put a computer in every school around the world? Because that is a vehicle for learning. So more to go, but this is the catalyst.
Great.
I mean, I have this table over here, Cheryl. So I do agree the New York Times would definitely showcase that, yeah. And this one, too? Let's hear.
So the New York Times might showcase it and then say that you stole our idea because it was ours first. No, I'm just kidding. No, actually, it's great minds think alike. So our idea was very similar in that it's an ECE portal. We call it Portal to the Future. And with this portal, what we really thought was we would incentivize the private sector to get involved. So it's something that could be geo-targeted. And the private sector in local communities anywhere in the world could replicate this model and kind of reskin it. But we'd incentivize them with tax credits and reasons why they should invest in this age group because it's tomorrow's workforce. But additionally, on this portal, what we would have is we'd have professional development events where it could be virtual communities as well as live events. So we could show parents and communities the relevancy and importance of investing in this age group. Also, there'd be resources for kids, so apps, things that are just platform agnostic, so no matter where the kid is, you can meet them in terms of, you know, if they can't read yet because they're too little, we have these apps they can download. Additionally, there's apps for the parents so that they can understand how to meet their children on these technologies where they live. And then also, we would, I'm just trying to make sure I've covered everything. Oh, yeah. So the values, because it's able to be geo-targeted and reskinned per the different communities and cultures and countries, we would be able to really create values in a cultural exchange. And so it would be sustainable because it would be investing based upon who they are and the needs that they have in that specific community. So.
Way to go.
Excellent. So we have time for one or two more. Oh, I see two hands. All right, they were fast. That one was really high, so we're going to.
Do you want me to hold your prototype?
Somebody should hold it.
I will
hold it.
Ooh.
Wow. Okay, so in the spirit of saving
magic
best for last, not to be competitive, we are calling this the Market Learning Club, and the concept is to take advantage of pre-existing Is this another nearby table competitive thing? Great minds. Okay, so we dropped a church. Sorry. So we're taking advantage of pre-existing locations like the market or the church where mom would go anyway and establishing learning clubs based either on 4-H or scouting programs where older kids are responsible for caring for younger, but they're provided with a toolkit that would enable some really fun learning activities to take place while mom is already at the market or the church. So the Market Learning Club. Market fell down too.
That is great.
Great.
Wow.
I'm taking some notes because I'm intrigued that we had a lot of technology, and now we have more of a community-facing solution. And I see this table might have something that builds on that, huh?
We also had the market as the hub. It's the hub and spoke approach with the markets, but we added to it that the SMS to the parents on their phones with age-specific information. We want to get the religious leaders involved. The way we're going to pay for it is different, though. The cell phone companies who get the distribution inside the countries, there's a tax on the cell phones that helps to fund this. And it includes educating one of the women in the village as the healthcare expert. And she is located at the village where we've also built a playground for the kids to play at the village, because a lot of the villages don't have them at the marketplace at the center. And we want to hook up with the healthcare providers in the community so that the physicians and the healthcare providers are talking about brain development, not just physical development, and teaching the parents about the importance of early learning education. Anything else from the group? Because we built on everybody else's ideas. And the what? And the van. We're out in the remote areas, we have a van that goes out to educate the parents and shares. We've thought picture books, because in a lot of cases, they don't have the ability to read information. But they also get the healthcare information that was provided in the marketplace. So we're out and about, hub and spoke. Okay, thank you.
Excellent. There we go. Okay, really quickly, this group in the back was sending me a please, we want to share vibe. So this is going to be the last one.
We felt like we didn't want to deprive everybody of our genuinely great ideas, assuming that we're still in non-judgmental mode. But we wanted to elevate the quality of education, and we feel like what we need to do is make the end result that an early childhood educator be like the most desired profession in the world. And so we started with accrediting early childhood education and making sure that curriculum was appropriate for the environment, engaging parents, increasing their engagement with what we're doing. This represents engaging parents, since it's got a lot of ideas. And then at the end, we have five-star teachers and kids who grow up wanting to be educators of young people because it's compensated well, and it's also got a lot of respect from the community at large.
Excellent. Great. Okay, well, that was amazing. I'm always amazed how in 8 minutes...
Yeah, how far you can
how
come.
How far people can come and how systemic your ideas could be. And if we think about not just the ideas that happen at the individual tables, but the ideas that then happen across the room, that 8 minutes was probably one of the most productive 8 minutes in history, huh? I don't know. Maybe there's other things you could debate. We could do that afterwards, yeah. All right, just to close the session, anybody want to share any quick thoughts they have about what that experience was like or anything that you heard in here that you consider you might want to take forward in some way? Did anything come up that you feel you are going to integrate into your work after this session? No pressure for that, by the way. Take a moment, meditate on that, yeah.
Necessarily involved in this area, and the kind of ideas that were coming out and the engagement, it was very significant, and I think it's very important to engage. I think for me, that means that we have to engage as many people that are not necessarily involved in this area as possible in order for them to understand, and once they learned and decide to address the issue, the whole community, as they were saying here, the village, you know, we all get involved in terms of resolving the issues in this area.
Great. I've also just been warned that we're actually quite over time, so if anybody has to leave, feel free to. And if anybody wants to continue, we'll... Yeah.
Is it there? Okay, very good. So I'll just say, I'm Lisa Jordan, I'm the director of the Bernard von Lehr Foundation. We've been in this field for 60 years. If you have an app that is you think is interesting for children under the age of 8, please come see me. That's all.
That's
I want.
That's a great offer. We don't even know what it includes, but it's a great offer. I am excited. All right, well, just in respect to time, I'm going to say thank you very much for an amazing session. Please hang out, chat with each other.
There are a couple of housekeeping things. If one of you, at least one of you, wouldn't mind putting your contact information, name and contact information, on the back of your concept worksheet. And also take an opportunity to exchange contact information, especially if the idea is something that you guys want to follow up on together. There is also a desk as you leave this space if you would like to formally put your name in with CGI to follow up with some of the ideas from here today. So please go ahead and do that. And thank you so much for your energy today. It was a pleasure.
Excellent. Thank you.